Okay, I explained that series is a sum of sequences. So if I have sequence an, then I define its finite sum as a1 plus a2 plus until an. So this is a finite sum, finite series. To see if you understand this, let me ask, what's S of 1?
A1.
A1. S of 2 would be?
A2.
S of 3 would be? No, the A2, S2 is not A2, sorry.
A1 plus
A2. A1 plus A2, right. And S3 would be?
A1
plus A2 plus A3. All right, so you have this. How about this? What's S3 minus S2?
A3.
This minus this will give you?
A3,
right? Okay. What if you have S of 101 minus S of 100?
A of 101.
Right? So in general, if you have S of n minus S of n minus 1, you should be getting A of
n.
A n. Now this is only true if n is 2 or greater, because if you have n as 1, then you get S of 0, which is not defined. But we will be using this for a proof. It's not that important in our class, but we'll briefly use this later. So let me just copy it down over here. An is Sn minus Sn minus 1. Let me erase this. Okay, now, summation from n through 1 through infinity of an is defined as the limit of this finite series. So if you take partial sums and make it go to infinity, then it'll be infinity. We actually tried this once for geometric series. So does anyone remember what's the formula for n from 1 through infinity of a times r n minus 1?
A over 1 minus 1.
That's very good, a over 1 minus 1. Now how did we get this? We found the finite sum, which was, this is really the limit of n going to infinity of a 1 minus r to the n over 1 minus r. And this was the finite sum. And when n is taken to infinity and r is a small value, it just becomes 0. And the result was this. Okay? So long, long time ago, we did that. Okay. Okay. Yeah, so that's this is not too important. I just wanted to point out that this is true. But actually, this is not always true. What was the condition for this to be true?
R is not 0. Yeah, I mean, R is not 1.
R has to be greater than negative 1 and less than 1. So for this to be true, R had to be between negative 1 and 1. And if you think about it, we did cover this concept of a series which converges and diverges. So since this is a limit, it can either converge or diverge, right? And we've seen those examples. We actually had two types of infinite series as examples. One was the geometric series, and the other was a telescoping series. We had examples of telescoping series which diverged and converged. Also, we had examples of geometric series that diverged and converged. Okay. So here's an example of convergent infinite series. Here's an example. N from 1 through infinity, 3, 1 half to n minus 1. What's this limit? Which is?
1 and 1 half, so 3 over 2.
3 times 2.
Oh, yes.
So you get 6. Now, intuitively, this is what it means. If n is 1, then this is 0th power, so it's 3. The first term is 3. So the sequence itself goes like this. 3, 3 over 2, 3 over 4, 3 over 8. And the series is the sum of these things. So you have 3 plus 3 over 2, 3 plus 3 over 4, 3 over 8. So you can see that the sequence themselves become smaller and smaller going to 0, whereas if you add them up, you get the value of 6. Okay? And the confusing thing in dealing with some of the sequences is that you have two kinds of limits. You have this limit of the sequence itself, which in this case went to 0, and the limit of the series, the infinite series, in which case it added up to 6. Because you start from 3, and then you add up 3 over 2, so that's bigger than 3. You add more and more, so it increases, 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 but it doesn't increase beyond 6. It just stops at 6. That's what happens. Okay. All right. Here's an example of a divergent infinite series. Okay, what about this? What are you adding? 3 and then plus 6 plus 12 plus 24 plus 48 plus 96. Okay? So the thing that you're adding is becoming larger and larger, and if you add them up, what's going to happen to the sum? It'll be infinity. Right? You have to think about these numbers individually, and just think about adding to a pile, and you're adding more and more and more, and it just becomes very big. And if you don't imagine with me, then it'll be really hard to see what's going on. You have to think 3, and then you add 6 to it, and then you add 12 to it, like it's getting bigger and bigger. So this limit would be, this summation would be going to. Now, if you think about the differences between these two, you kind of see some relationship between the sequence themselves and the series. It looks like if the thing that you're adding piles up and it falls below an upper bound, right, then the thing that you're adding should be getting closer and closer to zero. It has to be getting smaller and smaller in order that it doesn't increase beyond something. If something gets, so if something like is a finite amount, say it, you're adding one again and again, what happens? It will just grow without bound, right? So you need the sequence themselves to be going to zero if the series themselves should become finite, to become convergent. Okay? So that's the first theorem I want to show. The theorem is if summation of n from 1 through infinity of an converges, then limit of an of n going to infinity is 0. summation n equals to 1 through infinity, an has some value, a. And because it's convergent, that means it's some finite value. It's not infinity. It's a finite value. Now, you realize that sigma n from 1 through infinity of an is, by definition, it's a limit of n going to infinity of the partial sum, the finite sum. So basically, I'm saying this is same as S of infinity. If infinity is here, then you get S of infinity. And then we use the formula I said I'm going to briefly use. This is the only time this will be used. So we have, since AN is SN minus SN minus 1, the limit of n going to infinity of an would be limit of n going to infinity of sn minus the limit of n going to infinity of sn minus 1. What's this limit?
Zero.
This limit is this, which is?
A.
What's this limit? The same thing as this one.
Just minus one.
Yeah, but it's plugged in infinity, so it's still S of infinity. S of infinity is what? It's this summation, which is A. So you get A minus A, which is 0. Okay. So that's the proof.
Can you explain why the second term is also A?
Yeah.
So I'm just saying that S of infinity, right, is this thing, which is equal to A. But if you plug in infinity here, that's S of infinity, right?
Okay.
So yeah, infinity minus 1 is infinity, so it's S of infinity. Okay. So that's proof. And this theorem is actually called the test for divergence. The reason for that is because it's only used to show that certain series diverges. So here's an example. Show that sigma n over n plus 1 diverges. Now, what's the limit of the sequence? Not the series, what's the limit of the sequence? N over n plus 1. If n is really big, what's n over n plus 1?
Small.
Does this go to 0?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This goes to 0?
No.
Trying to think about it.
It's 1.
It's 1. The limit is 1, okay? All right, so the limit is 1, right? Because when you plug in million, it's like million divided million 1. That's almost 1. Right? Okay. Right? Okay. So you keep adding 1s. So at some point, you're adding to this pile something that's close to 1. You add 1 over and over again, you get infinity. So that's the intuitive reason why this should diverge. Okay. Now, the correct way to show that it diverges is to just say that the sequence goes to something that's not 0, because that's what it says. Okay. Proof: limit an of n going to infinity, this is 1, which is not equal to 0. You have to say it's not equal to 0. So by the test for divergence, this series diverges. That's how you say it. You should always say test for divergence.